Me Ty Doty Walker. Ramon Morales always assumed he'd die young, and when he finally turned 18, that suspicion cemented in fact. Driving his 1963 Rambler Ambassador had been Ramon's one escape from the certainty he faced. Yet even on those empty lanes, those bucolic back roads, he had no trouble in imagining his own death. Usually, the scenarios involved the explosion of a hidden landmine like the ones waiting for him overseas, or he might envision being pummeled unconscious by the bloody hands of some arrogant entitled bigot like that Tommy Milner kid. But no matter how far he drove or how fast he pushed the engine, Ramon never once expected that his death would be foretold in the pages of an old book. Then again, he probably wouldn't change a thing about his life, drastically shortened though it might be, because in finding that cursed book, Ramon also found the one person who treated Ramon like he too was a person. Not just a social security number on a draft letter, or a teen with dark skin who fits some preconceived profile of how a criminal should appear. No, when Stella looked at Ramon, she made him feel like he had a future, a life, for as long as it would last, anyway. Ramon rested his head on the holding cell bars. He felt the metal vibrate against his skull as another peal of thunder rumbled outside. The rain pelted against the police station's roof and windows, making the cinder block walls seem all the grayer. The only warmth in the place came from the fireplace in the corner, and from Stella, who occupied the cell next to Ramon's. With nothing else left to do but await the inevitable, Ramon's mind drifted back to when he first arrived in Mill Valley 4 nights ago. He'd been driving due north ever since he received his draft papers in the mail. It wasn't just that Ramon was afraid to die. He was. He had seen enough friends return from combat in pieces, in body bags. But no, what scared Ramon more than losing his own life was taking the life of another. Yes, he was scared of dying, but he was even more scared of killing. Ramon had witnessed enough bloodshed in his hometown to last multiple lifetimes. He'd seen guys get stabbed in knife fights with other gangs. He'd studied the scars left by those gashes and the terrible stitchwork done by incompetent doctors the poor could barely afford. He'd watched cousins suffer misunderstandings with the police, then get carted off to serve time for crimes they did not commit. And now Ramon was expected to do what exactly? Fly off to the other side of the world and rob other families of their sons? He struggled to reconcile those impersonal, neatly typed marching orders. How could he defend his country on foreign soil when his country couldn't defend people like him in their own neighborhoods? The trek to Canada had taken Ramon up through the entire length of Florida, and the path made him think of a funny saying he heard back in his old stomping grounds. In Florida, the farther north you go, the deeper south you get. The sight of Confederate flags still billowing in front of courthouses made Ramon want to push the pedal to the metal. Yet he didn't want to go so fast that he'd get pulled over either. Those good old boys sheriffs Ramon passed in each town didn't look like the patient or understanding sort. That's why he obeyed every speed limit, signaled each turn, and kept his eyes on the road, stopping only long enough to refuel, and only when it was absolutely necessary at that. The pattern continued through Georgia, the Carolinas, and beyond. Ramon dared not rest until he got as far north as his bleary eyes would allow. Reaching Mill Valley, Pennsylvania, he decided that the sleepy little town was as safe a place as any above the Mason-Dixon line to stop. Except Ramon didn't like the way Chief Turner eyed him when the Rambler turned down Main Street. The lawman's glare reminded him a little too much of the incriminating looks he received in the southern states. Ramon figured his best bet was to park at the drive-in, pretend to take in a couple of Halloween movies while he slept, and then be back on the road before the sun came up. He must have only been out for a few minutes when Stella and her friends hopped into Ramon's car. The sight of the girl dressed as a witch, and the fear in her eyes, jolted Ramon awake faster than any cafecito. Stella and two boys had been on the run from a local bully. Ramon knew the type. He had to fight off a few himself back in the day, only to take the blame for the bully's aggression each and every time. So when Tommy Milner caught up with Stella and the others and started banging on the Rambler's windshield, Ramon wanted to deck him immediately. But Ramon knew that he shouldn't. That he couldn't. Because even though it was Tommy who was instigating violence, Ramon would be the one found at fault by a jury not comprised of his peers. Ramon didn't want that just as much as he didn't want to be zipped into an army body bag. Not now. Not this close to Canada. No. Ramon decided to keep his cool, keep his head down, keep his eyes on the road. He drove Stella, Chuck, and Augie to the one place they thought they'd be left alone. Some crumbling old mansion they called the Bellows House. It was there that Stella found the book, just as she'd found Ramon. It was there that the stories within its arcane pages began to claim the lives of those who'd wandered into the Bellows estate. Now that people were disappearing, Chief Turner had locked up Ramon and Stella and was already building his case. Hispanic kid blows into town, a switchblade in his possession, local kids go missing. Open and shut, really. And the chief's exhibit A would be the Bellows book, which he poured through at the front of the station. Ramon could hear Turner scoffing from his cell. Me Ty Doty Walker? He heard the chief ask aloud in confusion. Lightning flashed outside, and more thunder rattled the holding cell bars. Ramon and Stella exchanged an apprehensive look. They then heard Chief Turner's imperious footsteps approach the holding area, followed by the trotting gait of his dog, Trigger. Of course he named his dog Trigger, Ramon thought in resignation. Which one of you comes up with sick stuff like this? Turner asked while brandishing the book he'd confiscated from them. Is it you, Stella? The chief had asked her the question, but his eyes remained bored into Ramon's. It didn't matter how Stella answered Turner's question. There was no way the policeman was going to let a draft dodger slip through his fingers, let alone one with a name like Ramon Morales. We didn't write them, Stella said. But no sooner had she spoken than the station's lights flickered out, drowning the holding cells in darkness, save for the fireplace. More lightning flashed outside, trailed in quick succession by a booming thunderclap and even heavier rainfall. Ramon guessed that Chief Turner would attribute the power outage to the storm, not the book in his hands. Trigger, on the other hand, seemed far less troubled by the dark. The dog curled up in front of the fireplace, a log splintered in the heat, issuing a cascade of embers that trailed up the hearth's chimney. Silence followed. Yet Trigger suddenly sat ramrod straight and stared at the fireplace. He cocked his head and raised an ear. It seemed he was expecting something. Chief Turner looked like he was about to call Trigger to his side when the dog started to make a noise. But he wasn't trying to growl. He was trying to talk.
We, I, really, were,
said Trigger the dog. Normally, the sound of a talking dog would have sent Ramon into hysterics. But that was before he entered Mill Valley. That was before he encountered the book that worked its witchcraft upon those unfortunate enough to read it. Chief Turner didn't seem too amused either, saying, How'd you make him do that? He cast another accusatory glare at Ramon, who locked eyes with Stella in turn. Once again, they said more to each other, with a look that most people conveyed with words, even though the two teens had only met a few days ago. What's the story? Ramon asked the chief. What happens in the story? Chief Turner considered the new chapter that he'd been reading, the one that he hadn't noticed when he first gained possession of the book, the one with the nonsense title. Lynchy, Kenchy, Collie, Molly, Dingo, Dingo! Trigger said before whimpering at the fireplace. What in Jesus' name is going on? Chief Turner wailed.
Rory!
Answered Trigger, eyeing the herd in alarm. Lynchy, Kenchy, Collie, Molly, Dingo, Dingo! What happens in the story? Whose name is in the book? Stella demanded from her cell. The chief, spooked into a stunned stupor, looked down at the book. But Ramon knew what he was going to say before Turner even read it. Ramon knew it was his name written in Sarah Bellows' book. Trigger stopped talking and recoiled from the fireplace just as a thumping noise echoed down the chimney. Something heavy and horribly hollow sounding rolled out of the flue, kicking up ash and coming to a stop on the floor outside the holding cells. It was a head. Are you shitting me? Chief Turner moaned. The head, with its quilt of mismatched flesh patches and wisps of straggly gray hair, split into a toothsome grin and said,
Me, Taito Walker!
Turner dropped the book and fumbled for his service pistol, then took aim at the leering disembodied skull. The chief of police then emptied his firearm into the head, shooting holes through it until the chamber clicked. The bullets had been spent, but still the head said, Me, Ty, Doty Walker! Its cataract eyes looked back to the fireplace, where a pair of decomposing feet spilled out of the hearth, followed by legs of differing lengths and skin tones. Clearly, they had originated from two separate bodies. Ramon then imagined a platoon of soldiers ascending ropes to the police station's roof, unzipping black body bags slung over their backs and dumping the contents down the chimney. Let us out, Stella implored. But Chief Turner remained rooted in place, watching as those legs toppled forward more times than they should have. They attached themselves to the stumps on the feet. More random parts rained down with fleshy thuds, a torso, arms, and hands. They all wriggled forward and assembled under the head. Gangrenous skin and sinew wove together in depraved mockery of the healing process. The bent figure of a man finally stood of its own volition, the gibbering head worn upside down.
Me, Ty, Doty Walker!
The jangly man shouted again. It spasmed toward the paralyzed Chief Turner and raised him bodily off the ground. The policeman had enough time to scream in fright before the jangly man snapped his neck. The simulacrum then threw Chief Turner's limp body against Stella's bars. Turner landed in unceremonious heap on the cold station floor, much in the way his killer had done so only moments ago. Ramon and Stella exchanged one last look of dread from across their respective cells. The jangly man crab-walked on all fours across the jail, sniffing the air at its fingers and toes undulated in millipede coordination. The obscene thing briefly paused to notice Stella before moving on to the next cage. Ramon backed against the corner of his cell as the jangly man left the floor and began crawling up the bars. While Stella reached out toward Chief Turner's inner body, Ramon grabbed the one piece of furniture not bolted to the ground, a stool, and wheeled it like the poorest excuse for a weapon ever. Clinging upside down to the cell, the jangly man began forcing his asymmetrical face through the iron bars. Ramon thought he could hear the crunch of bones before the impossible being once again said,
Me, Ty, Doty Walker!
Jesus Christ!
Ramon muttered while standing clear. He vaguely perceived Stella shouting at him and him shouting something back across their cells. But Ramon's eyes remained glued to the jangly man, who had shoved his skull past the bars, followed by a dislocated shoulder. Next, ribs snap this way and that as the chest cavity compressed and squeezed into Ramon's self.
Coward!
The jangly man screeched with a swipe of his arm. Ramon dodged the jagged, groping fingernails, then spotted Stella again. Only she was outside of her own cell now, desperately trying to open Ramon's with the late chief's keys. The jangly man had pulled most of himself through the bars. All that remained was a protruding hip and the accompanying leg, which leaked pus everywhere. Ramon grimaced, feeling the abomination's graveyard breath on his face, then looked back at Stella. She fit the right key into the lock, turned it, and flung open the cell door. It slammed against the adjacent bars with a resounding clang, momentarily disorienting the jangly man. Ramon chucked the stool, ducked another fitful grab from those rotted hands, and scrambled out of the cell. Stella reclaimed the bellows book off the floor where it had been dropped, while Ramon reclaimed his switchblade and Chief Turner's car keys. They ran past the booking desk and out of the station, with the writhing jangly man left trapped between the bars, until its body spontaneously disassembled. The various components dropped to the ground inside and outside of Ramon's former cell, then started worming toward each other again. Ramon and Stella burst through the station's front doors. Rain fell in droves, soaking them. Yet the book in Stella's arms remained strangely bone dry. Hurry! Stella yelled as they rushed toward Turner's police cruiser. Ramon stopped just shy of unlocking the doors. He wanted to protect Stella just as he had on Halloween night, just as she had protected Ramon in the holding cell and every other waking moment he spent in Mill Valley. But Ramon realized that his fate had already been written. He had known it before some army secretary licked the envelope that held his draft letter. If he let Stella stay with him, he'd only be putting her in danger. This was one more ride Ramon would have to take alone. What are you waiting for? Stella asked. Go to her house, Ramon said. He didn't even need to say the name. The word Sarah Bellows transmitted wordlessly between them, as so many other things had in the span of 4 short nights. Tell her the truth, Ramon said to Stella. That thing will follow me. Stella checked nervously over her shoulder, but the police station remained eerily still. As much as it pained her to admit it, she said, the stories come true every time. Then you better run fast, Ramon replied, more to save Stella than to save himself. Stop her, and you will stop this. More silent understanding passed across the space separating them. Ramon watched Stella push aside her conflicted feelings and run away from him toward the storm. He then climbed behind the cruiser's steering wheel, twisted the key in the ignition, and heard the engine turn over. Fighting every survival instinct he possessed, Ramon waited, until the jangly man sprawled out of the station. It roared its inhuman cry, followed by the clash of another bolt of lightning. Ramon slammed the car into drive and floored the gas. The cruiser fishtailed on the wet asphalt and sped away, with a jangly man galloping after in frantic pursuit. It felt good to break the speed limit for a change. If Ramon was going down on this night, he was going down swinging. He pushed every button and switch he could see on the dashboard, stopping only once he activated the rooftop siren. Red and blue lights pulsed around the rain-streaked surroundings, giving Ramon a strobe-like view of the dark road around him. He then heard a faint whine come from behind. Ramon looked through the patrol car's rearview mirror and saw Trigger staring plaintively from the back seat. Rain matted the dog's fur, and Ramon angled the mirror to see one of the rear windows had been left rolled open earlier in the day. "Ay, Cabueno," Ramon said sarcastically. "Listen, dog, if you start talking again, I'm driving us both straight to Penhurst." Trigger lowered his head in shame, and Ramon sighed. He pumped the brakes, and 4 tires skidded on the slicked road. Shaking his head, hardly believing what he was about to do, Ramon hopped out of the car, He opened the rear door from the outside, and Trigger leapt out of the back seat most gratefully. "Go on, boy, go!" Ramon hollered as Trigger scampered into the nearby woods. "I hope your next owner isn't such an asshole." Ramon got back in the driver's seat, shifted into gear, and stomped hard on the gas pedal. Pistons pumped and fuel combusted under the hood, giving off so much horsepower, Ramon could feel it vibrating through the chassis. He topped 60 within seconds, then 80, the red and blue lights still swirling as the cruiser tore through Mill Valley. Even with the windshield wipers flicking back and forth at their fastest setting, Ramon had trouble seeing the road through the downpour. He squinted through the beaded glass, then felt the entire vehicle shudder with a loud bang. Ramon wondered if he flooded the engine and caused it to backfire. His eyes saw a face in the windshield, and it was not his own reflection. The Jangly man leered back from the outside of the cruiser. Its head had finally gone right side up, and was close enough for Ramon to make out more of the details afflicting its appearance. The two eyes bulged milky white around the pinpricks that passed as their pupils. The wide mouth held so many teeth, it almost looked as if two different sets of jaws had been fused together, and a long circuitous scar ran like a ragged seam down its face. Not even the most inexperienced field medic on any battlefield, or the most incompetent emergency room doctor in any ghetto, could have done a worse job patching a body back together. The Jangly man reached around and tried to open the driver's side door from the outside, but Ramon quickly pushed down on the door lock pin with his elbow, never letting up on the accelerator. Undeterred, the Jangly man then punched and kicked in the windows. Glass and rain struck Ramon, and only now did he jam the brakes. The inertia sent the Jangly man slipping down the cruiser and dangling across its front bumper. Ramon watched the wretched disparate parts all work in concert. Limbs from men and women tried to stabilize their gestalt form on the wet hood. Muscles flecked under an undead fabric that had been knitted together by skin both light and dark. In its discordant motions, the Jangly man represented to Ramon everything that could be great about humanity, and all that was not. The two figures stared at each other through the windshield for a tense moment before Ramon put the cruiser in drive yet again. Pulling hard to the side, Ramon veered off the main road and struggled to latch his seatbelt in time. The buckle clicked into place just in time, and Ramon braced himself against the steering wheel. The Jangly man had just enough time to swivel its head around 180 degrees and see the parked semi-truck. Chief Turner's cruiser slammed into the side of the truck, making an accordion of the cruiser's front end and blowing out all the windows and tires. Ramon felt his body lurch forward, then get sent back just as violently. But the safety belt held, and he maintained consciousness. Slumping out of the dented driver's side door in a daze, Ramon got to his feet and looked back. The Jangly man was pinned between the ruined cruiser and the semi. The uneven arms remained motionless, and its mishapen head lolled to the side. A moment later, the ramshackle body parts self-amputated and fell. They landed lifelessly in an iridescent puddle that was equal parts rainwater and gasoline. Ramon Morales always assumed he'd die young, and there was a good chance he still might. But in the meantime, he would try to find Stella again. He would do everything in his power to feel alive in her presence for as long as possible. Ramon would outrace death until he couldn't anymore. He limped away from the crash and toward the Bellows estate, on the run again. The rain never let up. The severed body parts tensed alive once more, and the Jangly man dragged after the boy, who was no longer afraid to kill.